Good afternoon. Can we settle down just a little bit? Good afternoon. Welcome. Welcome here this afternoon. My name is Maria Blanco. I want to welcome you on behalf of the PPIC Board of Directors. We're really pleased to present the program today. And also, you will see on your table the latest survey, which was just released today, which is very exciting and timely. I want to thank, to start with, I want to thank Senator Pro Tem Kevin De León and Republican leader Chad Mays. Am I pronouncing that right? We decided whether it was with an E, without the E, but it is Chad Mays, who's been here a month as leader, right? And 14 months? 14 months. So welcome. Welcome to Sacramento. This is the first event in PPIC's speaker series, a series that we're extremely proud of, where we try and focus on California's future by listening to people that are involved in designing that future to some extent in our legislative process. It's not always legislative people that we interview, but it is a lot of the time, and that's why we hold this event in Sacramento. And this event wouldn't be possible if it weren't for the sponsors of the speaker series. And luckily, I don't have to name them all because they're on the screens to both my right and left, which is wonderful. And we're also very lucky that this series is funded by the PPIC donor circle. And those are individuals and organizations that help fund this series. And the reason it's important that we have our sponsors, both organizations and individuals, is that we can do make these programs free. And we can do them free in person, like at this luncheon, and we can also do them free online. And we're very committed at PPIC to making sure that we become part of a public conversation with you. The other thing I wanted to encourage you to do is to think about how you can also join that donor circle or our sponsors. We try and broaden that not just because we broaden our economic support when we broaden that circle, but because we also broaden the conversation when you join us, and that's extremely important to us. So if you're interested in doing that, we have many staff people here today that would be glad to talk to you about how you can help us with our sponsorships. We're going to get started, but I want to make sure I cover a couple of housekeeping items. One, right after we finish, you're going to get an email, and it's going to ask you how we did. And we really encourage you to fill out the survey because we really do look at them and try and improve every time we do one. We try and do a little better. The other one is the usual admonition to make sure you silence your cell phone. And then onto the program, the first person we're going to hear from is PPIC's Associate Survey Director, and that's Dean Bonner. And Dean's going to present some highlights from the latest statewide survey that you have on your table. Thank you very much, Dean, and here, turn it over.
All right, thank you very much, Maria. And I'd echo what Maria said about the survey. It's really helpful for the survey team and the organization as a whole to get feedback on these great events that we're able to have. I'd like to apologize in advance. I'm suffering a little bit of a cold. It's the peril of having an 8-month-old baby in your house who recently started daycare, so I apologize. So I'd like to start off today by saying that it's a pleasure to be here and present some of the key findings from our January PPIC statewide survey. The governor and the legislature have begun the second half of a 2-year legislative session with a good fiscal situation, yet they face many challenges. 2 unresolved special sessions that sought to provide funding for transportation infrastructure projects and for Medi-Cal have been included in the governor's budget, thus setting up potentially contentious budget deliberations. Beyond that, it appears that 2016 could be a busy year for the initiative process, with prospective ballot measures that could extend the Proposition 30 tax increases, legalize marijuana, increase the state tax on cigarettes, increase the minimum wage, make gun laws more strict, and as of yesterday, potentially relax sentencing rules. just to name a few. So as the governor and legislature begin the year, they do so with near record high approval among Californians. Positive perceptions extend to the prospects of the governor and the legislature working together and accomplishing a lot in 2016. However, there is a wide partisan divide on each of these views, with Democrats far more positive than Republicans. Partisan divisions also color Californians' opinions of the state budget situation. The perception that the state budget situation is a big problem is at a record low. Nevertheless, Republicans are twice as likely as Democrats to hold this view. When it comes to the governor's recent budget proposal, Californians are divided today. This is a change from recent years, when more than two in three Californians, including more than half of Republicans, were in favor. Why the change, you may ask? One word: taxes. In recent years, the governor's budget proposal had not included tax increases, while this year, his current proposal includes taxes to fund transportation projects and Medi-Cal. As you might expect, Democrats and Republicans fall on different sides of this question. A major point of contention in recent years has been what should be done with budgets, with surplus budget funds. Californians continue to be divided on this issue, with majorities of Democrats preferring to restore social service funding that was cut in recent years, while an overwhelming share of Republicans would prefer to pay down debt and build up the reserve. As I mentioned, there are several high-profile initiatives that could likely be on the November ballot, and thus we've been asking about the importance of potential ballot measures. This month, we find that majorities consider the issue of stricter gun laws and increasing the state tax on cigarettes to be very important, while fewer view changing the state's pension system or requiring statewide approval for revenue bonds to be very important. Moving from the policy landscape to a few issues that have been discussed on the campaign trail, we find that following the December terrorist attack in San Bernardino, a record high 43% of Californians think that terrorism and security is a big problem in California today. This perception is 12 points higher than in December 2001, just months after the September 11th terrorist attack. Half of Inland Empire residents call terrorism a big problem today, while fewer than half elsewhere in the state hold this view. Given the events in San Bernardino and the likelihood that there could be an initiative on gun regulations on the November ballot, we asked Californians how they feel about new gun laws. When asked to choose, 6 in 10 Californians think that government does not do enough to regulate the access to guns, while 1 in 3 says the government goes too far. As we found in the past, an overwhelming majority of Democrats say that government does not go far enough, while solid majorities of Republicans say that the government goes too far. In one of our more consistent findings dating back to the year 2000, Californians continue to view immigrants as a benefit because of their hard work and job skills, rather than a burden because they use public services. More than half of Californians across parties, regions, and demographic groups view immigrants as a benefit, with Democrats, Latinos, and younger Californians the most likely to hold this view. Republicans are by far the most likely to call immigrants a burden. And California voters have also continued to express bipartisan support for immigration reform, even as the presidential candidates many of the presidential candidates have signaled their opposition. So these are our new findings on public opinion that set the stage for a conversation with legislative leaders today. We look forward to keeping you informed about Californians and their government in what should be an eventful year as the state and nation chart its course for the future. I'd like to now invite Senate President Pro Tem Kevin De León, Assembly Republican Leader Chad Mays, and PPIC President Mark Baldassare to the stage. We look forward to this conversation.
Well, you saw it. They were shaking hands, and this is good. This is what we want to see from our legislative leaders,
exactly.
Getting along. So that's terrific. Well, thank you all for being here today. We just had a tremendous turnout to this event, and I think that it's the beginning of the year, and we all are eager to learn about what the direction of our legislative leaders are today, and now that we've learned some things from the governor's new budget and his state of the state, we have an opportunity to hear from our legislative leaders. I don't think that either of these gentlemen need introductions, but I will just, because you know them and they've been written up, but let me just say briefly that Kevin De Leon, who is the California State Senate President pro tem, represents the 24th District in Los Angeles. And we had the privilege in October 2014 of having Kevin on this stage for a program on new legislative leaders. And you're not a new legislative leader anymore. You've been around now longer than who will be the other legislative leaders within the next few months with a new speaker coming on board. And Chad Mays, Assemblymember Chad Mays, is the Assembly Republican leader from the 42nd Assembly District, which is in Riverside and San Bernardino County. And I met Chad last March when we were visiting with all the new members of the legislature and had the privilege to spend some time in the office. And here we are today, less than a year, and now you're in this position of leadership. There's one question which, just as a starting point for today's conversation, and we hope to take it in many different directions, but we sent in advance a question for you, which was not unlike the question which we asked 1,700 Californians in our recent poll. What do you think are the three most important issues for the governor and legislature to work on in 2016? And we'll start with the Senate pro tem.
Well, thank you, Mark, first and foremost. I'm so honored to be here once again with the good folks from PPIC and with my good friend, the new Republican leader from the State Assembly, Chad Mays, and to each and every one of you, it's an honor. I think there's a handful of issues that are still before us. Something that I've been saying with much consistency is that we are the seventh largest economy on planet Earth. So we have the seventh largest GDP. It's much to be proud of. If you disaggregate the data, you can look at much of the coastal areas, the Bay Area, Orange County, Los Angeles, as well as San Diego. Economy really starting to pick up and really boom. The Bay Area, South Bay Peninsula, it's somewhat like the Gilded Age, if you will. If you disaggregate the data again and you look towards the Central Valley and go towards the Inland Empire, parts of the state, large parts of the state, have not felt the economic positive resurgence. So it's a tale of two states. So I think that the issue of income inequality is obviously very real. The data is there. Parts of the state are enjoying really robust economic growth, but other parts of the state have not yet to benefit from that growth. So I think income inequality is very critical. We still have to deal with the issue of water. Coming back from Australia and spending 10 grueling days in Australia, I learned a lot from the Australian experience. They are suffering their 12th consecutive year of historic drought. The issue of water, really key targeted investments, particularly in higher education, I believe, if we're gonna give every single child a real opportunity to succeed. And lastly, I would say, and I know it's the fourth one, but we still have to move forward with a climate change, with our climate change leadership that's correlated with real jobs and provide real economic growth for all Californians.
And Assembly Republican Leader.
Well, it's good to be here. Thanks for joining us in a conversation today. As was said, it's a little fascinating for me to be up here on the stage knowing that I just got elected to the Assembly just 14 months ago. At one point in time, as an elected official, I always thought I was the youngest guy in the room. At the age of 38, I realized I'm not always the youngest guy in the room any longer. But there is, with only 14 months of experience here in the Capitol. There's still a lot to learn, and we are we are diving in. You know, in regards to the question of what the top three issues, it's tough to really say what the top three is. I would agree in our districts we still hear a lot about water and the lack of water infrastructure in California. Of course, there's going to be some disagreements on what's important, what it is important. It's great that it has been raining, especially up here in Northern California, maybe in large part because of El Nino. But the last time that California invested in new water storage, there's been other districts that have done that, but the last time California did was back in 1979, and I was 2 years old in 1979. So we haven't done a very good job of investing in water infrastructure, and we've got to do a better job at that. Transportation is one of those things that is of concern. There's a lot of conversation. We know that we're in an extraordinary session on transportation. There hasn't been a whole lot of dialogue yet, but everywhere that I go in California, in fact, as Republican leader, they send me all around the state talking to folks. And whether I'm in Southern California, whether I'm in Orange County, San Diego, Riverside, San Bernardino, whether I'm in the Bay Area in San Francisco or Sacramento, I'm stuck in traffic everywhere that I go. So we know that there is a problem. Of course, the question always comes up of what is the proper way of coming to a solution. So I think we're gonna have a lot of those conversations. And then the one thing I'm gonna have to agree with Kevin on is there really is this tale of two Californians. You know, on the coastal areas, he's exactly right. If you drive up the one, whether you're in San Diego and you drive up through Orange County all the way up, you'll see, wow, California is full of a lot of wealth. And people are doing really well here in California. If you're in the Silicon Valley, you're making a high income. But out in the Inland Empire, out where I live in Riverside and San Bernardino County, if you're up in the Central Valley, that is not the way that life is there. People are struggling to get by. Home ownership, the affordable housing, we are in a crisis with affordable housing, which I also think the policies that have been made here in Sacramento have created that. So it costs twice as much to be able to buy a house here in California as it does in almost every other state in the nation. And so we've got to do a better job here in Sacramento focusing on restoring the middle class in California and also focusing on those who want to be in the middle class. And I think the way that we do that is we reduce a lot of the regulatory hurdles, a lot of the barriers that we put in place that have created that.
Thank you. And I do want to come back to income inequality and growing the middle class later on in our program. But Assemblymember Mays, you mentioned transportation. In our poll, we found that majority of Californians believe that the governor and legislature are going to work together and get a lot done this year. And one question that I have is about where things left off with the special session last year in terms of both healthcare spending and transportation funding. Where do you see things going next? I mean, I think we recognize that these are important areas of funding that are not resolved, and they're in the governor's budget now. And so where do things go next in resolving those big issues?
Well, with regards to the MCO tax, which is really critical to all of us, I think we're very close. And I think that there has been some very good, earnest negotiations with the health plans, with the governor. I know that Senator Ed Hernandez, who's the chair of the Health Committee in the Senate, has worked tirelessly over the course of the break. I think we're very close. We have no other choice, because if we do not strike some sort of deal, we're talking about a $1.1 billion hole in our general fund. That means there's going to be some very brutal, draconian cuts. We're growing our economy. We're backfilling to the best of our ability while being fiscally prudent. Some of the programs that have suffered greatly from the worst economic recession since 1929. So we need a fiscal balance, but that's why dealing with the MCO tax reform, basically, because it's tax reform, it's very complex in how to describe the sort of the gymnastics of how this works and offsets, but it's tax reform, And I think we're very, very close. It's a real treat for me to engage with my Republican colleagues in the Senate, with the leaders, Senator Gene Fuller. It's been very constructive with my Republican colleagues. With regards to transportation, we all agree. We have a crumbling infrastructure, our roads, our highways, our bridges are in need of dire repair. We can grow this economy simultaneously. It has a large multiplier impact. This is something that we're going to have to do together, Republicans and Democrats. There's no other choice. You can't spin your way out of this one. We have to work constructively and proactively together if, in fact, we're going to make the right investments to grow this economy once again, because this has a multiplier impact to put people to work and grow that middle class and sustain that middle class.
So the two issues, right, MCO, the MCO tax, and also transportation. We'll talk about the MCO tax first. Does everybody know what the MCO tax? Raise your hand if you know what the MCO tax. A bunch of smart people in the room. the MCO tax that was that we currently have, I'll just call it a way to be able to steal money from the federal government, which is what we've had over the last, since the mid-2000s. Very smart, but it was a way for to take money from the federal government to put it in to be able to fund the general fund. Well, great, because we're a donor state, so it makes sense to be able to try to get as much of that back here to California as possible. Well, the feds got wise to the idea and said, you've got to hold all of the managed care organization plans. You can't hold them harmless, so it's got to be a broad-based system. Well, I was on the committee that took a look at it. By the way, when I got elected to the assembly, I had no idea what the MCO tax was. So again, you guys are much smarter than I am. But I spent a weekend really digging into it. And it seemed very clear to me that the first proposal that we had during the extraordinary session was that we were going to be taxing, it was about $600 million, which is the increase. We were going to be taxing 24 million Californians. And we were going to be taxing them on their health plans to be able to fund, to make sure that we got this money. Assembly Republicans, along with Senate Republicans, said that's just not acceptable. So the administration went back to the drawing board, and they said, you know, we've come up with a new plan. And this new plan, we have yet to see all of the details, and like the pro tem said, it's incredibly complex, and if there's a lot of gymnastics, that's a great word, I'm gonna steal that, a lot of gymnastics to be able to get there, but it looks like there's a possibility that the feds might be okay with it, but the devil's still in the details. You know, when you look at it, you look at something that's very convoluted and complex. We've got to make sure that it's good for all Californians. So we're digging into that. So I think there's some hope there. Again, I can't promise anybody that yes, there's absolutely going to be a deal there, but I do think that there is a possibility, maybe a high probability. But again, the devil's in the details. When it comes to transportation, and I'm just going to be very real, and I know I'm being recorded, so I guess I should be careful. It's difficult because if you look at, and it's not just amongst Republicans. I don't know if I can speak on the Senate side, but on the Assembly side, I don't know of anybody that agrees that California's transportation system is in a great state. It's not. We have failed to be able to fund transportation for not just a few years, but for decades in California. So our deferred maintenance, the backlog is tremendous. And we've got to be able to figure out a way to be able to solve the problem. That's just the deferred maintenance. That doesn't include the capacity, the new capacity that I was talking about a little bit ago. When I drive all over California and I'm stuck in traffic, we've got to be able to deal with that as well. In the Inland Empire, just as a quick aside, the average commute is 65 miles every single day. So if you work 8 hours a day and you're stuck in traffic, you're more than likely going to be away from home for 12 hours every single day. So you get to see your kids on the weekend. That's not much of a standard of living that we should be, that should not be the standard of living in California. We've got to be able to fix that. The question then, is how do you fix that? I think a great way to start is all of the money that is currently collected that's transportation related needs to go towards transportation instead of being diverted to other general fund programs. The second thing that has to be addressed is that we've got to fix the system. It's an incredibly convoluted system as well. I remember back last session when I saw chart C that Caltrans puts out, which is this 40 inch by 40 inch big map on the wall, and it has to be a map because if you look at the way transportation is funded, it's an incredibly complex, convoluted system. We need to look for efficiencies in the system to be able to figure out how to maximize the resources that the taxpayers have given us. And I think those are the first two things that we've got to begin with before we start talking about raising new revenue.
Thank you. Did you want to add anything?
No, I think the only thing is going back to the issue of transportation. Mm-hmm. This is something that we're going to have to do together, mm-hmm. Both Democrats and Republicans. We're not a state of binary choices, mm-hmm. So leadership is about making very difficult choices. And we have to be smart in how we do this, because if we use, general fund dollars or almost exclusively general fund dollars, we have to understand what those consequences are. We don't want to let criminals out of prison because we use general fund dollars. We don't want to take away from children who deserve quality child care. We don't want to take opportunities away from young men and women who are studying and working hard in high schools, whether it's a rural area, Republican, suburban, urban area, for their opportunity to go on and access higher education, whether it's a CSU or UC school. So we have to do this intelligently. We may make some very difficult choices. We don't know yet. But there's something that's absolutely certain, is we're going to have to do this together.
Because you need a two-thirds vote. And then, of course, the governor's approval on this, too. And maybe even the voters. Who knows? I want to come back to the issue of poverty and inequality after the recession that California had, very serious recession, something that in our polling, Democrats and Republicans agree that this is a state of haves and have-nots. They agree that that we have a problem with a shrinking middle class, growing gap between the wealthy and those who don't have enough resources. PPIC's done a lot of work on it. Foundations have tried to are working on it and will be working on it more. The Irvine Foundation now has identified economic opportunity as a major focus. So Democrats and Republicans agree that it's a problem and bring different solutions to the table. And recognizing that maybe it's going to take different solutions, I'd like to hear if there are any concrete proposals this year that we might expect from Democrats and the Republicans, and whether there might be a few that have, which there's some bipartisan agreement.
Well, I'll start. We talk about poverty. I think you first have to understand the problem. So what is it that we're referring to? If you look at the official poverty measure in California, our numbers are about the same as where the rest of the country is when it comes to the official poverty measure. But when you use the supplemental poverty measure, another index that looks at cost of living, your housing cost, the cost of childcare and other things, California has the highest poverty rate in the nation. So let me say that one more time. California, as great as it is, I've lived here virtually all of my life. California has the highest poverty rate in the nation. So if you were to say, what's our standard of living compared to other states? California's standard of living, according to that supplemental poverty measure, we have a lower standard of living than Louisiana, than Alabama, than Mississippi, than Idaho, than any other state in the country. To me, that's just absolutely unacceptable. Well, why is that? In large part, it's because of our housing crisis that we have in California. If you think about housing is, if you call it a commodity, there's a price for something. There is supply and demand. We need to build about 1 million new units in California to keep up with the demand. Why is it that it costs over $400,000 a year, or $400,000 to be able to buy a house in California, and yet it costs about $200,000 to buy that same house in Texas? Why is that? Well, it's because of the regulatory environment that we have here in California. It's because of the uncertainties that we have in California. And look, I was on a town council in a little tiny community, and when I was I'm looking at Chris McKenzie, and he's like, uh-oh, what's Chad gonna say right now with the League of Cities? And the truth is, there is NIMBYism is also a very real problem, whether you're in a community that's full of Republican city council members or planning commissioners, or Democratic city council members or planning commissioners. So we've got to be, it's a very large issue that we've got to figure out a way of being able to build more homes in California to be able to increase the supply and hopefully bring the prices down. And then also, you have to look at the policies that we've put in place here in California, especially when it comes to energy costs. It costs 40% more for residential energy at a home than it does for other states. It's about 70% for businesses. And what impact does that ultimately have on the middle class or those who want to be in the middle class? Well, one of the impacts that it has is it has an effect on the types of businesses that want to operate here in California. Back in 2000, there was 1.9 million manufacturing jobs in California. Today, it's just over a million manufacturing jobs. Those are good-paying, middle-class jobs that you don't need a college degree for. In the Inland Empire, in Riverside and San Bernardino County, those counties that I represent, 47% of the working population hasn't spent a day in college. And so you can think education is the answer, and absolutely education is the answer, but that's the answer for the next generation. That's a 15, 20, 25 year issue. What are we doing about the people that are 35, 36 years old, who live in the Inland Empire, who have a couple of kids and have to drive 65 miles one way or both ways to be able to get to work or in their cars for 12 hours? What are we doing for them? Going and getting job training or something else isn't necessarily the answer. We need good paying, good quality, middle-class jobs here in California. And the policies we've put in place here in Sacramento have made it incredibly difficult for those businesses to be able to succeed. So we have to look at the root cause.
Well, I think that this is clearly an area arena where you'll see much contrast or juxtaposition, if you will, with regards to the present as well as the future. What we're trying to do in the Senate, Senate Democrats, is recalibrate a new economy of tomorrow. I think we've done this with policies which have been outside of the realm of the legislative branch, which is Proposition 39, the creation of jobs that are real and tangible for energy efficiency and upgrades, retrofits throughout the state of California. Just recently last year, my measure, which I understand has sucked up a lot of the energy here, last year, Senate Bill 350. There's a rhyme and reason with regards to the methodology and what we're moving. We're not just reducing carbon, GHG, and cleaning up the air that our children breathe into their lungs. Interestingly enough, obviously the Central Valley and Inland Empire have among the worst air quality and highest asthma rates in the entire nation. But what do we do actually positively, proactively, with intentionality to actually create a new economy of tomorrow and create jobs that are real, jobs that are tangible, jobs that you can actually count, jobs that you can't outsource next door to Nevada, Arizona, or a few states over it, like Texas, or offshore, if you will, to Guangzhou, China. In the past few years, we've actually created, with intentionality, through our policies, 455,000 new jobs in California in the clean energy space. Majority of them are energy efficiency, as well as the renewable space, whether it's residential solar or utility scale solar, as well as wind. This is our future, and this is our reality too. With regards to rates for individual rate payers in the state of California, they're actually among the lowest in the nation. If you compare it to the state of Texas, Texas individual rate payer at their own residence pays a higher utility rate than they do in the state of California. Why is that? Because these are the policies that we have moved with intentionality. We have reduced our energy load. It's because of energy efficiency. It's not by pure luck. It's not market forces that have done this on its, the market forces have done this on their own. This is with intentionality, moving policies that create a new economy of tomorrow. These are jobs that are real and tangible. I'll tell you one thing right now, with regards to manufacturing jobs, we hear a lot about Texas. We hear a lot about Louisiana, Alabama, and other states. We have more manufacturing jobs in the state of California than the state of Texas. In fact, our GDP is $2.35 trillion. It is twice as large than the state of Texas. You have Alaska, who today, and I was just with the Republican leader of the Senate in Alaska just a few weeks ago. They have a $4 billion economic budget deficit. It doesn't sound like a lot in comparison to our deficits in California, but when you have a state that has a population of 750,000 residents in that large, gargantuan state, that's a big number right there on a state that's dependent almost exclusively on revenues from fossil fuels. So what is it that we can do collectively to recalibrate a new economy tomorrow and measure? And plus, with regards to the Central Valley, as well as the Inland Empire, whether it's Imperial, San Bernardino, Riverside County, how can we actually create manufacturing jobs and locate them in these specific areas? And one example, Proterra from South Carolina, Charleston, South Carolina, electric bus company. They just relocated from South Carolina to California. And I did ask the question, what were you guys doing in South Carolina to begin with, you know? And they said, well, we were there because BMW's manufacturing plant is in South Carolina. So if you buy a Beamer and it's made in North America, most likely it comes out of South Carolina. He says, we're now here in California. We've set up shop in the peninsula in Burlingame. Our manufacturing base is in Southern California. It's in the city of industry. We're going to make electric buses, and we want to be closer to our market because it's the policies from California that have moved us from South Carolina, the Southeast, to the state of California. And we have to continue to move these policies with intentionality, and then you can quantify and verify actual jobs that have been created. That is the future for California.
And will there be a next round of climate change and energy policy legislation this year, given where things left off with SB 350 last year?
Well, I'll tell you one thing right now. With doubling down on our energy efficiency and with a 50% goal on our RPS by 2030, both by 2030, obviously you make reference to the 50% reduction in petroleum use by 2030. There's a lot of conversations taking place right now. Well, I can't answer that question right now, but we know that there will be more climate change policies. Be mindful. Climate change policies aren't made in a vacuum. Mm-hmm. They're not to say we want to be the number one on planet Earth, and therefore we want to reduce X amount of metric tons of GHG, mm-hmm. and whatever the consequences are to the economy or to ratepayers, so be it. No, not at all. The end goal objective is to actually reduce your utility rates, so when you open up, because that's what counts at the end of the day, is what your bill is, what you pay is what counts for a rate payer mm-hmm. on a monthly basis. So it's to reduce your actual utility rate, simultaneously grow the economy, and at the same time, clean up the air, whether it's carbon, whether it's atmospheric, or other criteria pollutants, which our children breathe into their lungs. And it's never factored in the total cost of doing business. The asthma rates in the Inland Empire, for example, are absolutely horrific. They're among the worst in the entire nation, and that's why I think Republicans and Democrats, we have to work together. And I'm excited to work with Chad. A lot of folks don't know, during the course of the break, Chad made it a point to come visit me. He came to Los Angeles, and it was actually the first time I had never met you before until a few months ago, you know? And it was a lovely conversation.
I just got here, by the way.
Yeah, I know. But that was a year and a few months still. They, you know, I didn't know who you were, you know? And it was a lovely conversation that we had. I really enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. And if we can build these relationships and cultivate these relationships, and sometimes we stretch on both sides that at times don't make our folks entirely happy. Yeah. But if we can do things for the betterment of the whole state of California, irrespective of your demographics or your political ideology, partisanship, that's what Californians want. Mm-hmm. They want bipartisanship. They want us to really tackle these hard issues mm-hmm. and not do so in an ideological way, yeah. but in a proactive way.
Yeah. Assemblymember Mays, I wanted to talk to you about something that happened in San Bernardino in December, the terrorist attack. And you notice from our poll that Californians are at a record high concern about terrorism. many Californians concerned about the threat of mass shootings where they live. What can the legislature do? What should the legislature do in the wake of that horrific event that took place in San Bernardino?
That's a great question. And if I can, maybe to make it a little bit more personal. So I told you that 14 months ago, I got elected in November, and I got sworn in December 1st of 2014, and then began the legislative session. On November 28th was my last day working for Janice Rutherford in San Bernardino County. So I worked on the fifth floor of the government center, where 12 of the 14 victims worked on the second floor. Now, it wasn't in that same building, but it was just down the road at the Inland Regional Center facility, where they were having a holiday meeting. So it was something very close and personal. You know, the members of the Board of Supervisors were touched personally because there were people that they know, and it was the county family. Even though there was 21,000 employees, it's still part of the same family. In my district, one of the victims was from the city of Yucaipa. The other one was in San Jacinto. And so it touched me personally. Not only did I know these people because I had worked closely with them, but I also represent them and their families in my community. So it had a great impact on me. Oftentimes, when issues come up, there is this sort of gut instinct, this reaction that says you've got to do something. And yet you have to realize that there are evil, awful people in this world that want to do evil, awful things. To give you an example, the gentleman that worked at the county of San Bernardino on the second floor, and they went, and some of the supervisors, my friends, went and toured where these victims were working. And the gentleman who did the shooting and created all this havoc worked in a cubicle right next to this guy who he shot, and that guy who he shot, and that guy who he shot. This was an evil person that wanted to do evil things, and I don't know what we can do in this world to be able to stop that. Oftentimes, people use these crises to try to get some sort of political advantage. You start thinking about things like gun control. And they had pipe bombs. They wanted to create havoc. They wanted to instill fear, and they wanted to take our liberty away from us. This is not something that is not real to me. I knew these people. I worked with these people. We've got to be very careful that when you see things like that and you begin to well up with this emotion, you want to go after these people, to think that something over here in the halls that we can fix evil. We have to be very, very careful, very, very cautious of the things that we do. I do think when you listen to the national, I probably shouldn't get into this, but when you hear some of the demagoguery that's going on the national stage today, that's not good, whether it's on the right or it's on the left. We have to realize that there are evil people that do awful things, and there isn't easy answers to those. What I would fear is that over here in this building, that folks would use this as a political advantage to get things done that they've wanted to get done for a very long time that had nothing to do with what happened in San Bernardino.
Do you want to add anything to that, Senate Pro Tem?
Well, I remember a young girl, 9-year-old, Chupa Wang's Wistery. She was a girl from Thailand. Angelino Heights, this was back in 2006. She was shot by two gang members who were actually going after each other. A bullet pierced the wall, hit her in the temple. Her mother was washing dishes. Actually, she was drying the dishes. Young Chirupa fell to the ground. Her mother thought she just slipped clumsily and leaned over, and she had blood pouring from her temple. Long story short, right before Christmas Eve, they pulled the life support and she passed away. This was about maybe a block and a half from where I used to live, in Angelino Heights, near downtown Los Angeles, near Echo Park. And it was bullets. And the crazy thing in California, and the crazy thing throughout the country, is we don't know who sells ammunition. We don't know who buys ammunition. And ammunition is the oxygen. It's the fuel that feeds the violence. it's quite crazy that you actually can legally walk into any Walmart, any bait and tackle store up in Tahoe. You know, you can walk into a big five store. You can actually rent a U-Haul truck, and you can fill that truck with all the ammunition you like. No questions asked. So San Bernardino is a watershed moment for us here in California, but we've had these moments in Newton, Connecticut, with the massacre at the elementary school. We've had gun violence take place every single weekend, every single month, every single year, throughout the state of California. Needless deaths, which have a gargantuan health impact, it has a gargantuan fiscal cost, it has a gargantuan psychological impact on our families. And for those who actually survive gun violence, whether they're paralyzed, the health impacts, the psychological impacts, the lack of economic growth as a contributor plays a major part. I think that we need sensible, to have a common sense conversation on this issue. I know that there are members of the Assembly as well as the Senate. I invite my Republican friends and colleagues to engage with us, but we have to have a discussion, mm-hmm. a continued discussion. This impacts everybody. And by the way, I know with Chapo Guzman, the leader of the drug cartel, Sinaloa, who was just captured just recently, about 78% of all the weapons that are found in Mexico, in Central America, are exported from the United States. Mm. High-powered assault weapons are coming in from Nevada, from Arizona, and from Texas, easily cross the border because they don't manufacture long guns, handguns, shotguns, or high-powered assault weapons. And the young man in Santa Monica College a few years ago who was mentally ill, no question about it, he attempted to purchase a handgun and a long gun lawfully. The law worked. He was denied the purchase of a firearm. However, what this phenomenon we have called ghost guns, and I know I've been heavily criticized through the internet by those who are pro-gun, he actually purchased lawfully the parts of a high-powered assault weapon, put it together at his home, and that's when he killed five individuals at Santa Monica College campus. So we have to have a discussion as issue, a very serious discussion, if in fact we're gonna protect our families, our neighbors, our communities.
Mm-hmm. Well, and there might be an opportunity for that this year with, you know, in the legislature. Let me talk about the fact that this is an election year, and there are a number of initiatives going to the ballot. The governor announced yesterday that he's has an initiative he wants to send to the ballot. Lieutenant Governor Newsom is promoting a measure to for stricter gun laws. There's minimum wage. There's Proposition 30. There's marijuana initiative. This year, the legislature has an opportunity to review those initiatives and then, you know, potentially maybe reach compromises. Do you see any of the initiatives that are in the formative stages now in which the legislature might really kind of try to get in there and see if there's a possibility for a compromise?
I always like to do work through the legislative process because our constituents, our voters elected us to do this work, even though it's difficult and some folks like when it's convenient to go through the ballot initiative and how the people vote. But I like to do it in the legislature. I think it's a wonderful opportunity. We are going to review all the proposed measures, unquestionably. Two, in terms of finding a deal for compromise, I think on gun, firearm, as well as ammunition legislation or the initiative, I think there is a real opportunity to do the work in the California State Legislature.
Do you see any possibility for measures that are coming to the ballot that which there might be a legislative solution?
You know, I agree with the pro tem. I think any time that it can be a legislative solution to our problems, we need to deal with it here in the legislature. I think when you have things that are on the ballot, you know, once it's implemented in law, if it's not a good law, then you got to go back to the ballot to be able to fix it.
So can I ask you two a question then? Yeah. What does it feel like to have the governor say, I'm going to the initiative process? not to the legislature.
On that one, at a tactical level, I completely understand the governor's perspective.
What is his perspective?
Number one, the little that I've seen with regards to what he's trying to accomplish, I'm highly supportive, and I give the governor a tremendous amount of kudos. Uh-huh. That would require 2/3.
Okay.
And I think that he made the calculation that it is not politically palatable for certain members on both in the Senate as well as mm-hmm. Assembly. So it's real politic. It's mm-hmm. a very pragmatic decision that he's made to move forward because it requires 2/3 in this mm-hmm. instance. In some instances, it tactically does make sense. In this case, 100%, it makes sense to go to the ballot.
Okay. And Assemblymember Mays?
Again, you know, I think the governor, for a number of different reasons, had decided to go. I haven't looked at the initiative yesterday. Uh-huh. In fact, I had my staff bring me a press release to be able to respond to it. And I said, you know, we need to look at the details before we start firing out okay. What we're going to say. So right. I haven't had a chance to take a look at uh-huh. the language in it. But I do know that there are conservatives yeah. and liberals who are supporting that right. initiative. Yeah. And I think that the governor is taking a look at it and saying, you know, we've got to be able to do something yeah. There, and he's going to give it a shot. I think that the pro tem is right. When you put before the legislature and running up to an election mm-hmm. year, sometimes those things can be used for as a political football. And I think okay. the governor's looking at it and saying, look, this is something that needs to be done. So we'll see.
Well, let me ask you too about governing in an election year. And I went and spoke to your caucus last year, and I'll be speaking to your caucus in a few weeks. How do you keep your caucus focused on governing and public policy while there's an election going on?
Listen, I don't think it's difficult at all.
Really?
The reason why I say that is I am so proud of the Senate Democrats. Mm-hmm. They have been amazing to work with. I've been honored mm-hmm. To be their leader yeah. last year alone. 2015 was an extraordinary year for the Senate, and by any objective means. Mm-hmm. We have real accomplishments that are having an impact, not just nationwide, mm-hmm. but globally. And that's because the Senate Democrats have really have become a very cohesive group mm-hmm. of individuals mm-hmm. That really care deeply about policy that impacts the human condition. So truth be told, it is not a major issue for the okay. Senate Democrats.
And as Assembly Member?
Well, I got to tell you, Senator De Leon is a much better politician than I am. because that was quite the response. You know, I'll tell you.
It's the right response. That's it's right, the correct
right,
one.
Right. Yeah. You know, it is... herding cats is often used... yes, exactly. When you're in the majority, you have a little bit more ability to be able to keep folks in line than you do when you're in the minority. But you're dealing with rational people, and you're dealing with sometimes, by the way, rational sometimes. you're dealing with folks who have different constituencies, and you know the beauty of a constitutional republic like we have. Is that you know we're not a direct democracy. You got to go back, and in the assembly, it's not every 4 years. You got to go back to your districts every week, and you go and you meet with them, and you during the interim, you listen to what they have to say, and it begins to have an impact on you. And so the issues in Inland Empire or in the 42nd Assembly District are different than those that are in LA, are different than those that are in San Francisco. And then you come back up and you have a conversation and you hope to be able to reason together. When you're going up to an election year, there are all sorts of dynamics at play. And there's so much misinformation now that gets out there that it tends to be able to skew the way where people are at. The one thing that was fascinating to me, just again talking about individuals, is you know one California is not a homogenous state. You know we're so vastly different from the north to the south to the coast to inland, but you've got people and you've got individuals who represent these districts who are so vastly different. I went around and tried to meet with every member of our caucus, the other 27 members of our caucus, to sit down to talk about priorities. And the one thing that stunned me, that shocked me, and it was shocking, was how vastly different, even in the Republican caucus, every single member is. Now, philosophically, they're all inclined to be conservative, but the way that they would approach things is so vastly different. And so when you're trying to corral all of them to be able to move in one particular direction, sometimes that can be a difficult task. I guess the pro tem is masterful in making sure that his members are moving all in one direction. But the election year does make it a little bit more more difficult because people are a little bit more skittish when they hit at least on our side, the yes or the no button.
Well, let me ask you,
Mark. Chad, you do have some closeted Democrats in your caucus,
yes, yes, yes. And you've got a few closeted Republicans,
right,
by the way.
Let me ask you a related question about governing in an election year. We appreciate the spirit of bipartisanship that we've seen here today. And how do you maintain that when you've got a presidential election going on and the kind of polarizing discussions that are taking place on the national level, that you can keep your focus, you two and your other two colleagues who are in the big four of legislative leadership, so that you don't get down in the mud on some of these political issues?
Well, listen, there's a couple things. In your poll, your PPIC poll, the state legislature as a whole is highly regarded. We are at maybe at 48%. We haven't hit the 50% yet, but those numbers have increased. They've increased, obviously, because the economy has grown. They have increased because we have really moved policies that have had an impact on folks. I look forward to working with Chad and with Gene Fuller, who is a wonderful Republican leader. You are right. At the national level, we've seen a lot of demagoguery. We've seen a lot of bigotry. Mm-hmm. We've seen a lot of comments that have no place in the political arena, especially during a presidential election. I know there's a lot of internal, you know, combustion going on within the Republican ranks at the national level. But as long as we continue to work in a cooperative fashion, we're not going to agree, obviously, on a lot of things. But if we can get some real tangible victories for Californians, for the betterment of California, we can stay above the fold and not be mired with this national discourse, because we're doing things very differently here in the state of California.
How do you see it?
Yeah, very much the same way. It's unfortunate to me to watch what's going on nationally. The way I describe it is the legislature is California's board of directors. You've got two different houses. You've got 40 in the Senate, 80 in the Assembly. But it's the board of directors. No different than when I was a council member and the board of directors for Yucca Valley was five members, or when I went to work for Janus in San Bernardino County and there was five members of that board of directors. We're the board of directors for California. We've got to make decisions in the best interest of the people that we serve. Now, this might come as a shock, but I actually like Kevin. I like Anthony. They're wrong, but I like them, and I want to be able to work with them. You know, just a few weeks ago when the vote came up for Anthony Rendon to be the next speaker, I was honored that Anthony had called and asked me if I would consider seconding the nomination. And my gut instinct said, yes, I'm going to do that. And Anthony was very kind and in the conversation said, you know, Chad, this might create some political problems for you. And I thought, well, who cares about that? You know, I don't really care about the political problems, but probably a good idea to give me a day or so to be able to think about it. And called a few of my members. They said, you know, that'd be quite the gesture. Well, when it got down to the vote or to his nomination, I was proud to stand up and say it's time for a change in California. And Anthony had reached out to me and said, we want to work with you guys, knowing that we have vastly different values. He's a self-described liberal, and I'm a self-described conservative. We are philosophically different. We want the same end. It's just the means in which we disagree on. I want to improve the human condition. I came from a community of folks who were the average household income is still less than $40,000 a year. I care about increasing the human condition, but the way that I think that we can do that is different than Kevin. But let's sit and reason together and forget about the demagoguery that's happening at the national level. In fact, it's disturbing and disgusting to me, quite frankly, the way that politicians act. We got elected to do the people's business, and we should do the people's business, even if we have differences of opinion and we disagree.
Thank you. And thanks. thanks to the both of you for your leadership. Let's take a few questions from the audience in the few moments we have left. I shouldn't take all the time.
I just had one question. Are you guys in sync with the governor on the budget that he said his proposed budget he'd come out with?
What I'll say is that I like the fiscal balance, and we're going to maintain the fiscal balance, but also believe strongly that we have to make certain targeted investments that will provide a greater return on investment for Californians. Investments in higher education, allowing folks to have a real opportunity to succeed. Certain targeted investments make sense if we're going to have continued economic growth for California.
Do you want to answer or take another question?
No, I'm happy to answer that as well. About being in sync, I got to tell you, I don't know if I could put put an average there, but 85-90% of what he said, or what his budget is, I can agree with. I think we've got to invest more in infrastructure than what we're currently doing within the general fund. But I think he's right to know that, California has this zigzag. He said that in the State of the State, this yeah. zigzag of money that comes in, and then we end up doing this, revenue comes in, we spend it, and then with new programs, then we cut those new programs. The way that, because of capital gains and economic ups and downs, we are very susceptible. So we've got to be very careful, we've got to be very cautious. We're in year five, year six now of an upturn. We've got record revenues, $7 billion more this year than last year, and we've got to make sure that if it's one-time revenue, then it's spent on one-time expenditures, and for me, that needs to be on infrastructure. I just think we need to be spending more money on infrastructure.
Good afternoon. So I'm from the Bay Area, which in many ways is ground zero for the self-described housing crisis that we do have in the state. And one of the kind of externalities of that is corporations also find difficulty bringing people here because those workers have difficulty paying for the housing elements. And I'm also a self-described conservative, so I think I would be in line with Leader Mays' analysis of the issue. But I was wondering if the pro tem would like to comment on how he thinks that perhaps in a bipartisan fashion we can really tackle the housing crisis, not only to benefit the low income in the state, but also as a means of regulatory reform to help corporations bring talented workers into the state.
Well, number one, we already have a tremendous amount of talented workers already. I'm not quite sure how much more regulatory reform you need. We have among the most talented workers in the world already in California. And as a result, a perverse result of the success of these corporations and businesses, they have outpriced themselves out of the very same market where they want better infrastructure and transportation, if I'm correct. So a lot of the folks who are doing extremely well have actually heated the market very much so in the Bay Area. That being said, I know that the Assembly Democrats under the leadership of Speaker-elect Anthony Rendon are working on a housing package along with the current Speaker Tony Atkins, and we're looking forward to engaging with them. We know that we have moved forward with a homeless package of housing, no place like home for those who are mentally ill, but this is an issue that I'm looking forward to dealing with my Assembly colleagues.
I want to take a question from this side of the room. We haven't had a question from this side of the room before. Nobody has a question over there. All the questions have been answered. How about over here? Sure.
First of all, thank you for dealing with a lot of important issues in California. One that I think you haven't touched on is that current laws, as they're currently written, are leading to the demise of the smaller alternative parties here in California. And also the lack of funding is leading to an erosion of the electoral systems here in California. And I'm wondering if there's any current legislation to deal with either of those problems.
That's a good question, and one that I was actually anticipating from this side of the room. But the question is really about the fact that we have, it costs money to run an election system, and are we giving enough money to the local registrars?
Pardon?
Well, listen, about the smaller parties, I can't give too much insight. I'm a big, proud Democrat, and that's who I am, you know. You know, born and raised, and that's what I'm going to be when I die, as a Democrat, you know. I think we're working on policies to really increase voter turnout and make sure that we have more folks coming to the polls. How do we make it much more efficient? How do we make it much more seamless? I know Senator Ben Allen, who is the chair of Elections and Constitutional Amendments of the Senate, is moving forward several bills to deal with the issue of how do we, you know, encourage more folks to come out to the polls, a whole variety of other issues. But that's the best I can answer. I don't know, you know, with regards to the smaller political parties, if you're going to talk about Citizens United, the Friedrichs case before the U.S. Supreme Court, the issue of money in the electoral system or lack thereof, or specifically only certain billionaires can play, that is going to erode our electoral system and make it much more toxic. There's no question about it.
And from the Republican side, have there been any proposals about how to improve voter turnout and our election system in California that you see maybe surfacing this year?
You know, nothing's coming to mind right now. Okay. You know, the one thing, we've got to make sure to provide an open system for people to be able to vote and one that there is no barriers. That really isn't the problem here in California. In fact, the one thing that's been shocking to me, you know, I studied political science in college, so I've been, you know, this sort of political geek for a long time, and that, to me, the thought that I wouldn't go to the polls, or I wouldn't, now it's so easy, you don't have to go to the polls, right? You get an envelope in the mail, you pull it out, you fill it in, and then you send it in. When you start to see in California the amount of people that get their ballot at home, they have to open the envelope up, fill it out and send it in, and you still have only 30 or 40% turnout. That's despicable. You wonder, why is that? Is it that people in California feel like their vote doesn't count? Maybe that's what it is. But we've got to be able to have folks who are engaged in the process, engaged in the electoral, I mean, look, I started knocking on doors when I was in junior high for elections for different candidates. I've always been very engaged, but it seems as though the problem isn't one of what government can do. It seems that there's just an awful lot of apathy amongst the electorate. And so the question is, what can we do to be able to stop the apathy?
Let me ask you one final question, because we're almost out of time. So I'll take the last question to both of you. In listening to both of you today and your different styles of leadership, but also your you know, important roles in leadership, what are your thoughts about what it takes to be a successful legislative leader today?
What does it take? My goodness, I just got the job a couple weeks ago. And I often joke.
But maybe you've seen other people in this role who are mentors or role models.
I often joke, people say, oh, well, you're under the new term limit, so you can be here for 11 years. And I say, yeah, or it could be the next 11 minutes. Right now, there could be a caucus meeting that I wasn't invited to. That. So you.
Wait, I just got a text.
I might need to run over to the building real quick. You know, everybody has different styles. I've seen one of the things that I did after it was the 2 weeks before session ended back in September, when I got the votes to be the next leader, which is, you know, a big honor, right? I mean, again, I'd just been here for a few months before, and all of a sudden now I'm the assembly Republican leader. And of course, because we don't have any statewide offices, between Gene Fuller and I and a couple members of the Board of Equalization, we're the highest ranking Republicans in the state. Kind of crazy for that to happen. But, you know, I ended up having conversations with former leaders, with Jim Brulte, Bill Leonard, Kurt Pringle, went around, traveled around, Scott Baugh, just to see how they did. And everybody has a different style, and everybody does things a little bit different. You know, the one thing for me is I want to be collaborative. It's not just, hey, what I go is how it's going to be. It's I want to work with the members within my caucus, and that together we're going to end up making decisions. We're not always going to agree even in the caucus. I addressed that a little bit earlier. But I think what is successful is making sure that you are able to represent the needs of of your caucus within your constituency. You get elected in your district, but my constituency now is I've got 27 other members of my caucus that I've got to make sure to take care of. Recently, I'll give you one example. You know, there's this idea of sort of being Machiavellian, where you rule with an iron fist, and you want to instill fear. Well, that's not the way that I operate. I think for me, it's more of it of trying to be. I prefer to be loved than feared, and to be able to meet with people, reason together, have rational conversations, and then come to some collaborative conclusion. Everybody's a little bit different, but that's my style.
Okay.
Yeah. Everyone has a different leadership style. I think patience is really critical. Listening. You have to learn how to listen. Not everyone knows how to listen. I didn't know how to listen correctly. And I learned how to listen. I think that you do have to have a vision. You have to articulate a vision to your caucus members, to the whole state of California. Will they buy into it? We believe strongly on the issue of climate change. The empirical data is there. One thing is to have strong political interest, try to derail it. But when you look at the data, which is quite consistent with voters across the state of California, they bought into this vision. You got to have that. Also, too, I strongly believe that as adults, we're lifelong learners. So we are continuously asking a lot of questions. I am learning, I am reading, I'm asking a lot of questions. I speak with George Shultz, I speak with Leon Panetta, I speak with a lot of folks across the political spectrum. I believe I'm humble enough to know there are a lot of things I don't know. The first thing, when I came up here as a legislator the first time, the one thing I realized automatically is there was more things out there that I simply did not know. And I really had to cloister myself with really smart people, surround myself, have an insatiable appetite for curiosity. If you have a insatiable appetite for curiosity and a strong work ethic, nothing's going to hold you back. You're just going to continue to move forward. But, you know, as the leader right now, we're always adapting. We're always learning. You're always learning. You're always learning. You're always learning. And still today, I'm still learning.
Well, I look forward to the year ahead with your leadership, and I want to thank you for spending this time with us today. It's been a very unique and very informative conversation. Let's give them a big hand. Thank you. Thanks. I would also like to thank our other program participants today, Maria Blanco and Dean Bonner. I want to thank our sponsors for making it possible for us to host this lunch today. Isn't this wonderful?
Yeah.
You know? And and I want to thank all of you for being part of this today. Have a wonderful afternoon. Thank you.
Can we take a picture?